Whoa, we just drilled a hole in my floor. From my first floor to my bedroom. Awesome. Watch out, this video might be considered as really, really boring and wrong.
We are live. Are there stones coming up?
Hello, Victor Kempenaerts here. You wanna know why there was a hole in my roof, eh? We will tell you later. So, today we talk about altitude. Altitude simulation, all those things. First, why altitude? Of course, now we have a lot of time, so we want to do whatever is beneficial to be in the best possible shape when we come back in competition. So now we have the time to use altitude. We have to stay at home, so it's altitude simulation in my case. And the main thing about altitude is increase your red blood cells. That is in the 90s, everybody was using APO to increase their red blood cells. Of course, that's totally not done. That's real fucking doping. We don't dope. But you can do the same thing with altitude simulation. The only thing is it costs a lot of effort. The question is always, what elevation, what altitude you want to be at? That depends, eh? Now, I aim to be very high. It's the first time I do it like this. Because we have so much time, I try to like eliminate the aspect of altitude out of my training and really focus on altitude. So I am very, very high. So I increase my red blood cells as much as I can. But the downside is that I cannot train a lot because my body is really suffering of the altitude and my training has to be reduced with more than 50%. I will do this for about 2 or 3 weeks, and then after I go back to 2,000-2,500 meters. And at that point, I will have a lot of red blood cells, so I can do more efforts on training, I can recover faster, I can train more in general. Of course, this is all marginal gains, but still I sleep at altitude, small altitude, 2,000-2,500. To extend the effect of the extra red blood cells. When I would not sleep at altitude anymore, after 2 weeks, it will rapidly go down, like the long-term effects will rapidly go down when you keep on sleeping at altitude, or when you sleep 2 nights every week at altitude, you are able to extend the effect much, much longer. And of course, you need a whole big construction if you want to do some altitude simulation at your home. I have a big tent at home. I got this from Frederik van Lierde. Who knows Frederik van Lierde? He's a fucking good triathlete. He won the Ironman of Hawaii once. And I asked him, maybe you have like some altitude stuff at home? Because I had this small tent and he said, I have this big tent. I will give it to you, and I will send you the invoice later. I got a tent, I said, I need this tent, and he said, just sign a jersey for my son. Thank you, Frederik, super cool. You can also have a room. It's not so hard to build a room. You should drill a hole to build a room. But it's harder to control because a room is a lot bigger, always a lot bigger than a tent. So it's harder to get to really high altitudes. That's why I'm still in a tent. But a small tent can be a bit claustrophobic, and your sleeping quality is a lot lower. And in my construction, I use a lot of altitude generators because of a few reasons. I have a few reasons for that. First of all, Svenes. He just gave me his altitude generator. Fucking awesome. Sven Nes, I think the first guy that had an altitude room at his home, he said, I have this 20-year-old generator. I don't know if it's still working, but you can have it, no problem. And it works perfectly. And then Adam Hense, Hanseno Company, he gave me a great discount. So now I have 4 altitude generators at my place. It's good for a few things. You have a lot bigger flow, you have so much more air running into your room, and it's really good because When the flow is low, you breathe a lot in the tent, the humidity in the tent gets so high, so that's a lot better. And also when you have more altitude generators, it's possible to generate real high altitude. With one generator, it's not really possible to go over, let's say, 3,500 meters. And then, of course, at my altitude generators, I have my lungs to make them silent. But you can see in a previous video, click on the link over here to see this video. And then, yeah, you need to have the hole in your roof. Eh? So we asked Johnny Clockboard. He came with his clockboard and he just drilled a fucking massive hole, like this, from my top floor to my bedroom. And then I can run the pipes. Yeah. It's really cool. But, and also cool because it's in another room. I don't have the noise. Only Jeffke is sleeping next to the generator. He has a lot of noise, but who cares about Jeffke? Eh? He only has to make a video the day after, so it's no problem. And yeah, point four, the measurements. What do we have to measure when we are in the tent? Of course, always wear your Garmin wearable. Important. You can see your sleeping data. You can see your heart rate. You can even see your blood saturation, which is really, really important when you're sleeping in a tent. I got questions. What blood saturations are you aiming for? If you typically we aim for a blood saturation between 95 and 90, depending on your sleep quality. If you sleep good, you can get close to 90. If you sleep bad, it's better to be closer to 95. People say you don't have effect if you're over 95. That's not true. I've been in Namibia with saturation never under 95, and I can tell you I was super good after 2 months in Namibia. But the effects will be there more rapidly when you have a lower saturation. I'm sleeping now very high. I go way under 90. But the downside of it is when you go under 90, your recovery will be really slow and trainings will be really hard. So that's why they typically aim between 90 and 95 to also be able to do good trainings. You have this device to measure how many oxygen there is in the air. That's always interesting because you have a small drift from the evening till the morning. Especially with one generator, this drift is a lot. With more generators, it's always interesting to measure to be sure at what altitude, you will see later on, you really are. And I use also a weather station to see the humidity. If I sleep really bad, is it because I was sleeping too high or was it too humid in my tent? And then now, really interesting, really for the smart people. What's the difference between real altitude and an altitude generator? Of course, the mental thing. If you want to be at real altitude for 2 months, you have to be on top of a mountain most of the time, or in Namibia. Namibia is cool. It's like in the city. You can go for lunch somewhere, or I don't know. But when you are in Livigno or on top of Terre, top of Sierra Nevada, it's pretty boring, but you are really focused. But you don't want to do this for a really long period. It takes a lot of mental energy. In a tent, you can just do it at home. I don't know, in November, just in after Christmas, you can jump in your tent. It's all possible. Mm-hmm. So that's important difference. But then you have air pressure and the percentage of O2. Because at sea level, everybody knows 20.9% of oxygen is in the air. But on top of Mount Everest, how many percentage of oxygen is in the air on top of Mount Everest? 20.9% it's the same. So what's the real difference? Ha! That's fucking difficult to explain.
So let's try and explain this. Let's say one unit is one breath. We have a breath at sea level. We have a breath at 5,000 meters where the atmospheric pressure is half of it what it is at sea level. And then we have one breath in my altitude tent at sea level with 10% of O2. The pink dots are molecules of oxygen, O2. The black dots are just molecules, whatever. Most of it nitrogen. At sea level, let's say in one unit are 100 molecules. We make it easy. We say there's 20% of oxygen at sea level. So in one unit of 100 molecules, we have 20 molecules of O2 and 80 molecules of other sources. Not so important what they actually are. And that's totally different at 5,000 meters, because over there the air pressure is a lot lower. So we only have 5,000 meters is half of the air pressure at sea level. So we only have 50 molecules in this one unit, and 20% of 50 molecules, so 20% of oxygen over there is 10 molecules of oxygen in the one unit. And as you can see, it's a lot less dense. When you have 10% of O2 at sea level, you have, because you're at sea level and the air pressure is at sea level, you have 100 molecules, but only 10% of O2, so it's only 10 particles of O2 in the 100 molecules, which is the same as at 5,000 meters. But there are a lot of other molecules also over there, so it's totally different than at real altitude. Because when you're breathing, you start breathing more heavily, so many more molecules are passing through your lungs. So it's not as good as real altitude.
And also, like, there are some other parts, like if you are sleeping on real altitude, you don't have to sleep in a tent, so it will not get really humid. You don't have the noise of the generators. And also, when you're at real altitude, when you wake up at night, you can just go to the bathroom and have a pee. I pee in a bucket in my tent because I'm dedicated. That's why I pee in a bucket. That's why. And then now, there's a thing, yeah. In some countries, altitude generators are forbidden. It's like doping. I'm not quite sure. It's like, I think Swiss, Italy. What is your opinion? I don't know. My opinion, I can tell you. Altitude is hard work. And it's just like, you will increase your red blood cells, but it costs a lot of effort. So why not? If you're not allowed to be in a tent, then you will go on altitude. So it's more or less the same thing. And going on real altitude is always better. And if it's not allowed to be on real altitude, then to be in a tent, if it's not allowed to be in a tent, then people living on real altitude, they have a big benefit over us. Let's see, to the Colombian riders. Of course, they perform well because they live on altitude forever. It should not be like that. They have a benefit that we cannot compensate. So if altitude generators must be forbidden, because you cannot generate an altitude that probably other riders, like Colombian riders or African riders, do have at their home place, let's say then we can also make it forbidden to ride on an indoor trainer, because people in Spain, they have good weather all the time and we don't have good weather, so we have to ride in the bad weather if we want to do our trainings. That's my thought. Now some Q&A. Stay tuned. Did you guess what the amount of calories was in the pie? That was your chance to win a jersey. But maybe later on there will be more chances. That's a complicated question. If you say you ride at altitude and you sleep at sea level, and you ride at sea level and you sleep at sea level, I think it's more or less the same. You will just produce less power in your altitude ride. But when you ride at altitude and you sleep at altitude, for sure you will need longer recovery. That's really hard to explain, to calculate. It's impossible, because when you want to sleep in the tent, when you want to sleep at altitude, you will always have to reduce your trainings on the bike. And when you do less kilometers on the bike, you will perform less on the bike. But when you have more red blood cells, you will perform better. Is it compensating? Is it overcompensating? God knows. Depending, what we most of the time say is the longer the better. At least 2 weeks, that's the minimum. But the longer, the more beneficial effect you will have. In Mexico was special because I had to perform at altitude. I went for 2 months to Namibia at more or less the same altitude as Mexico. Then I came back, I did Tirreno Adriatico, and I did a few nights in an altitude hotel in Belgium. And then after, I went for 3 weeks in advance of the record to Mexico. I slept in a tent to increase the altitude. I slept at 3,300 meters to perform at 1,888 meters. That's more or less the preparation. Let's say a modest setup would be, if you look really well, Hanseno has good prices, 2,000 euros, 2,500 euros. My setup, let's say 10,000 euros.
What is the highest point in Belgium?
Alex Dowsett, good question. I don't know, 500 meters, something like that. Barak Frituur. Have you ever climbed Barak Frituur, Alex? I am now at about 4,200 and I will go to 4,600, not higher. If you go like 5,000 meter, like your body is slowly dying. I sleep 5 to 6 days a week at altitude. When I have an important training, I don't sleep at altitude the night before. The studies say that 5 nights a week, at least 10 hours a night in the tent, should be enough. I believe so. I think it's possible. I've never been altitude sick in a tent or outside of a tent, but I believe it's possible. When you sleep in a tent, depends, it's all how good are you adapted to the altitude, how high are you sleeping. I'm sure when you sleep at 5,000 meters in the tent, you will be really weak the day after on training and you will probably lose about 20% of your FTP. But when you just sleep at 2,000 meters and you're really adapted, I think it will be hard to see any difference.
Okay, thank you very much, Victor.
That's it?
That's it.
Okay.